The year 2000 concludes a century of the ecumenical movement. Christians from the entire length and breadth of the world have been actively engaged throughout the 20th century in realizing their vision of unity in two phases. The circle of the first phase has already been closed. In the realm of so-called practical Christianity, the theology of love and common service of the world, divided Christians are now united, in spite of the dogmatic differences that still exist between them. Nestorians and Monophysites, who broke away from the Orthodox Church in the 5th century, Papists, who split off from her in the 11th century, an assortment of Protestant communities which disavowed papism in the 16th century, and Orthodox ecumenists, who have never represented the entire Holy Orthodox Church. These are all striving to deliver a common Christian message to the world. But can this message ever constitute an authentic invitation for the world to return to the truth and unity of the Church, when the ecumenists are not only not united in the unique truth of the Fathers and Synods of Orthodoxy, but are not even disposed to repenting or accepting this truth? Practical unity without truth in the context of the ecumenical movement, a counterfeit unity based on dogmatic syncretism, presents the image of a false Christianity, which certainly has absolutely no connection with the one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church of Christ. The Orthodox ecumenists are in a state of continuous decay, which is especially evident in their relations with unrepentant, heretical papism. At the close of this century, it appears that the tragedy of the 15th century is being repeated. The Orthodox, in the face of great dangers and historic challenges, are once again divided into unionists or ecumenists and anti-unionists or anti-ecumenists. Could it be that we will lament a new fall of Constantinople? The ever-memorable Serbian dogmatic theologian, Father Justin Popovic, wrote with uncommon accuracy and discernment, "There are three falls in history, the fall of Adam, the fall of Judas, and the fall of the Pope." Was he perhaps exaggerating? To begin with, it should not be forgotten that in the Lateran Treaty of February 11, 1929, the Vatican was proclaimed an independent and autonomous state under the sovereignty of the so-called Holy See. The Pope of Rome is the absolute and lifelong monarch of the Vatican State. He is also the supreme arbiter of its legal, executive, and judicial authority. The Vatican State has a prime minister, a secretary of state, ministers, an economy, a diplomatic corps, an army and a police force. It also mints its own currency and issues its own stamps. Modern popes have apparently not forgotten the papo-Caesarist fantasies of the notorious medieval Pope Innocent III, 1198 to 1216, who, puffed up with conceit, made the following statements in his enthronement address. "He who has the bride is the bridegroom. But this bride, the Church, was not wedded to me with empty hands, but offered me a dowry of incomparable value, that is, the fullness of spiritual goods and the breadth of temporal goods, a magnificence and abundance of both. As a token of spiritual goods, she has granted me the mitre, and as a token of temporal goods, she has given me the tiara. The mitre for the priesthood and the tiara for the kingdom. And she has appointed me representative of him on whose vesture and thigh is written, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. But the fall of the Pope centers primarily on the so-called primacy of power and infallibility of the Pope. Because the infallible Holy Spirit was dishonored by the heretical filioque clause, and therefore departed from the body politic of the Vatican, a man now personifies the foundation, the headship, the power, and the infallibility of the so-called Roman Catholic Church. The definitions of the Pope, the Second Vatican Council, 1962 to 1965, proclaimed, among other things, are irreformable by their very nature and not by reason of the assent of the Church. They are not in need of the approval of others and do not admit of appeal to any other tribunal. For the Roman Pontiff does not utter a pronouncement as a private person, but rather does he expound and defend the teaching of the Catholic faith as the supreme teacher of the universal Church, in whom the Church's charism of infallibility is present in a singular way. The Roman Pontiff, by reason of his office as Vicar of Christ and as the pastor of the entire Church, has full, supreme, and universal power over the whole Church, a power which he can always exercise unhindered. It is quite obvious that the Pope, a mere man, has usurped the God-man Christ, and that papism has been transformed into an anthropocentric system which is becoming more and more secularized. Since the papacy has not renounced its identity as a state, its anthropocentrism, or its concomitant secularization, how can it carry on a dialogue with the Orthodox? How is it possible for the Orthodox Church, whose center is the God-man, this bride of Christ, which is animated by the Holy Spirit, to engage in dialogue, joint prayer, and joint activities with a secular state that passes itself off as religious? And with it, to open the doors to the third millennium? On January the 18th, for the first time in history, Anglicans and Orthodox took part in a notable ceremony in Rome, which concluded the anniversary year 2000. Pope John Paul II, in a ceremony that was ecumenical in character, together with the primate of the Anglican Church, George Carey, and Metropolitan Athanasius of Thera from the Patriarchate of Constantinople, opened the door of the Basilica of the Holy Apostle Paul outside the walls of Rome. Praying together with them were representatives of 22 Christian communities, 11 Orthodox churches, including that of Greece, and 11 others from the entire spectrum of the heterodox. Did this act of inter-Christian worship not constitute a dialogue based on mutual acquaintance or a de facto recognition of papism as a church? And does it not constitute a sacrifice of the truth on the part of the Orthodox ecumenists? How could the Orthodox ecumenists participate in joint prayer at a papist ceremony, and cooperate with the leader of the Anglicans? Is the ordination of women not a deadly sin which undermines the apostolic tradition?
Τους ο διάλογος με τον Πάπα, με τους δυτικούς. Πρώτα απ' όλα, εσείς πώς τον αξιολογείτε και αν βλέπετε να έχει κάποια προοπτική.
Εγώ πιστεύω καταρχήν στους διαλόγους. Άλλωστε η Εκκλησία αποφάσισε τη διεξόγη των διαλόγων. Ο διάλογος με τη Ρωμαιοκαθολική Εκκλησία είναι ένας επίσημος διάλογος της Ορθοδόξης Εκκλησίας. Και νομίζω ότι πραγματοποιήθησαν ήδη ορισμένα σπουδαία βήματα στην όλη πορεία αυτού του διαλόγου. Πριν όμως έχουμε το χρέος να βοηθήσουμε ουσιαστικά το διάλογο προκειμένου να έρθουν οι παραξηγήσεις του παρελθόντος και να γνωρίσει ο ένας τον άλλον όπως πραγματικά είμεθα. Δυστυχώς για πολλά χρόνια, για δεκαετίες και εκατοετρίδες, οι γνώσεις μας για τους άλλους ήταν επηρεασμένες από την έλλειψη επικοινωνίας, από την αμάθεια, από την κληρονομία του παρελθόντος ή από την παραπληροφόρηση. Πιστεύω ότι σήμερα έχουμε χρέος να συνυπάρξουμε με αυθυπαρξία. Ίσως να μην καταστεί δυνατόν να αποκατασταθεί πλήρης κοινωνία μεταξύ των εκκλησιών μας, διότι έχουμε εμπόδια να ξεπεράσουμε. Θα πρέπει όμως τουλάχιστον να φροντίσουμε να μεταδώσουμε ό,τι ουσιαστικότερο και αυθεντικότερο έχουμε από κενού να μεταδώσουμε, χωρίς να αλωτριώσουμε το ουσιαστικό περιεχόμενο της πίστεώς μας. Κανένας δεν είναι διατεθειμένος να προδώσει την αλήθεια. Δεν θα θυσιάσουμε την αλήθεια, αντιθέτως θα θυσιάσουμε τα πάντα για την αλήθεια. Καλούμεθα όμως να θυσιάσουμε κάτι. Την μυσαλλοδοξία μας και την φαρισαϊκή κάποτε επίδειξη των τίτλων της ιδιοκτησίας.
Στην λίγη Μετροπολίτη Δαμασκήνος.
Metropolitan Damascenos of Switzerland, together with those who share his views, has truly made many sacrifices in ecumenical dialogues. Unfortunately, however, they have not been attentive to the main thing, and so they have forfeited it. Their consciousness that the Orthodox Church is the one and only Church. This is precisely why they hobnob with the heterodox, in a way that is unacceptable at papist worship services and ecumenical fora, confusing the boundaries of truth and heresy.
Diese Anwesenheit verbindet die Welten, die hier auch geografisch zusammenstoßen. Das liberale Westeuropa mit seiner Vielfalt der
Υπήρξαν κοινές εορταστικές εκδηλώσεις μεταξύ προσώπων του Οικουμενικού Πατριαρχείου και της Ρωμαιοκαθολικής Εκκλησίας κατά τη θρονική εορτή του Οικουμενικού Πατριαρχείου, δηλαδή του Πρωτοκλήτου Αποστόλου Ανδρέου ή κατά την θρονική εορτή της Εκκλησίας της Ρώμης, την εορτή Πέτρου και Παύλου την 29η Ιουνίου.
It is evident that when the ecumenists of the Fanar take part, and officially at that, in highest point of the Vatican's liturgical life, that is, in its patronal feast, they are not engaging in dialogue with papism, but recognizing its putative ecclesiality. Metropolitan Damaskinos of Switzerland, is a champion of the theology of sister churches. On the basis of this theology, Orthodoxy and Papism are supposedly sister churches in the full sense of the term. And he has the audacity to proclaim that the unity of Orthodox and Heterodox is a given, because the existing dogmatic differences represent different theological terminology for the same faith, corresponding to our particular cultures and complementing each other in a legitimate variety of theological traditions. Metropolitan Damaskinos, downplaying the anti-evangelical character of heresy and granting an amnesty to the very serious dogmatic deviations of papism, becomes a heretic himself when he declares, "We, Orthodox and Heterodox, belong to the same family, which is the Church, the body of the living Christ." The recent visits of the Pope in 1999 to Orthodox countries, for the first time since the Schism of 1054, proved yet again that ecumenism, as an ecclesiological disease of epidemic proportions, is relentlessly hitting many regions of the Orthodox world. Ecumenist polites leads the Orthodox into unceasing compromises, sacrifices, and concessions. The gradual loss of any sense of the nature and destructive power of heresy, not to mention the blatant and unacceptable hobnobbing with the Heterodox at places and times of worship, were more evident in Romania than at any other time. How, one wonders, could the Orthodox have allowed the leader of the Vatican State, wearing vestments, to attend the synodal liturgy at which Patriarch Theodosius of Romania presided? How could an Orthodox Patriarch have been so oblivious to the heretical character of the Pope as to have allowed him to join with him in blessing the Orthodox flock? And all of this, notwithstanding the fact that Uniate aggression, even in Western Romania, in Transylvania, under the full protection of the Vatican, has driven the Orthodox Catholic dialogue into a complete impasse.
Και κρατέωσον βασιλείς ους ηγάτης ας. Αμήν. Ρικόρδατι in primo luogo, Signore, del nostro Santissimo Padre, Giovanni Paolo, Papa di Roma, dell'Arcivescovo Carlo Maria, e concedi alle tue sante chiese che essi vivano in pace, incolumi, onorati, sani, longevi, e dispensino rettamente la tua parola di verità.
Why do we observe this compliant attitude towards the Vatican State and John Paul II, its Pope Caesar, when it is a known fact that Vatican diplomacy continually torpedoes the sincerity and credibility of this dialogue? Could it really be that the tragedy of the 15th century is being repeated? How is it possible for the Orthodox ecumenists to hope for any aid whatsoever from the Pope when he has lost the treasure of the truth and his sights are always set on proselytizing. The pious old calendarist Orthodox anti-ecumenists lament the fall of their ecumenist brothers who are constantly yielding to the papal imperium. They lament the capture of Orthodox Romania and Orthodox Georgia. Is the truth not sacrificed when honors are accorded to the leader of the Vatican State by the entire Orthodox hierarchy of Georgia, and indeed lined up along with the representatives of other religions? In February of the anniversary year 2000, the Heresiarch Pope visited Mount Sinai, where God walked. The Brotherhood of the Sinai Monastery did not, unfortunately, maintain the proper Orthodox stand. The honors accorded to the leader of the Vatican State added to the damage already inflicted on Orthodox truth and ecclesiology. The abbot of the Holy Monastery of St. Catherine on Mount Sinai, Archbishop Damian Nos, appears to be traversing the broad and destructive avenue of ecumenism. The strongholds of Roman Hellenism, one after the other, instead of making an heroic stand against the papal imperium, are offering earth and water to the destroyer of orthodoxy. It is well known that at the Second Vatican Council, 1962 to 1965, papism opened up in a spectacular way, not only towards other Christians, but also towards the other religions of the world. Thus, it was the first to inaugurate interfaith dialogue.
In 1971, Paul VI invited me to bring a choir to Rome to sing for the Mission Sundays with all their Samoan costumes. It was the first time we used Samoan costumes for the Mass.
The syncretistic theology of culture was the basis of this venture. Elements of local cultures, which had been formed without Christ, are now entering into churches and adulterating the spirituality of Christian worship.
Before, whatever is Samoan was more or less sinful. It is the Holy Father who encouraged us to sing in church with all the Samoan costumes and things like that. So that's how I started.
In the end, the theology of culture takes a positive attitude towards other religions, which themselves, according to Metropolitan Damaskinos of Switzerland, constitute legitimate paths to an alleged common God and Father.
Έχετε ξεκινήσει ένα διάλογο και με τους Εβραίους και με τους Μουσουλμάνους. Είναι η πρώτη φορά που ξεκινάει επί των ημερών σας ένας τέτοιος διάλογος. Και ποια ήταν η σκέψη η ύστερη?
Οι διάλογοι αυτοί ενεθαρρύνθησαν από πανορθόδοξες αποφάσεις. Το έτος 1976, η πρώτη προσυνοδική πανορθόδοξη διάσκεψη στο Ορθόδοξο Κέντρο του Οικουμενικού Πατριαρχείου ενεθάρρυνε την επικοινωνία με εκπροσώπους άλλων θρησκειών, προκειμένου να διακονηθεί ο σύγχρονος άνθρωπος ανεξαρτήτως εθνικιστικής, φιλετικής ή κοινωνικής άλλης προέλευσης. Κατά αυτόν τον τρόπο ήρχεσαν πρώτη διάλογοι, ο πρώτος διάλογος, πρώτη διμερής ακαδημαϊκή διάλογη μεταξύ Ορθοδόξου Εκκλησίας και του Ιουδαϊσμού. Ενισγυνιάστηκαν το έτος 1976 στη Λουκέρνη, στη Θεολογική Πανεπιστημιακή Σχολή, της οποίας είμαι καθηγητής. Και το έτος 1986 αρχίσαμε την πρώτη μας ακαδημαϊκή συνάντηση με τον πρίγκιπα της Ιορδανίας, την οργανώσαμε δηλαδή, τη Βασιλική Ακαδημία της Ιορδανίας με το Ορθόδοξο Κέντρο του Ιορδανικού Πατριαρχείου αντίστοιχα, και έκτοτε οργανώσαμε μέχρι και το τελευταίο έτος, μέχρι τον Δεκέμβριο, τον Νοέμβριο του περασμένου έτους, και την ενάτη μας ακαδημαϊκή κατά σειρά διάσκεψη. Πρόκειται να οργανώσουμε την επομένη εντός αυτού έτους 2000, ίσως στο χώρο της Ελλάδος, και οφείλω να σας πω επίσης ότι ιδρύσαμε στη Γενέβη ένα ίδρυμα δια πολιτισμικών και διαθρησκειακών ερευνών και διαλόγων, το οποίο προχωρεί το έργο του, και εύχομαι και το ελπίζω συντόμως να έχουμε τους πρώτους καρπούς.
Thus was the ground laid for the syncretistic theology of world peace and for the creation of a new civilization of peace and love through the cooperation of the world's religions. The first meeting of religions for world peace in 1986 in Assisi, Italy, with the participation of 12 religions and, unfortunately, of Orthodox ecumenists, underscored the leading role of the Pope in the worldwide syncretistic movement towards the pan-religion of the new age. Since 1986, the papists have been organizing similar interfaith meetings in different cities of Europe. The 13th meeting took place at the Vatican from the 24th through to the 29th of October 1999, with the general theme on the threshold of the third millennium, cooperation between different religions. A very wide range of religions were represented. Christians, Muslims, Jews, Buddhists, Shintoists, Hindus, Sikhs, Zoroastrians, Confucians, Mandeans, and others were present, with significant numbers of high-level delegates. The Patriarch of Constantinople was represented by the well-known veteran of interfaith dialogues, Metropolitan Damaskinos of Switzerland. The Pontifical Council for Interfaith Dialogue, under the presidency of Cardinal Francisco Arinze, was responsible for organizing the meeting. Ceremonies marking the conclusion of the proceedings were held on the afternoon of October the 28th in St. Peter's Square in the presence of Pope John Paul II. Concerts presented by the religious communities attending the meeting gave their own particular kind of witness.
Khalina المحبة وأمان خلينا نمشي إيد بإيد نزرع بقلوبنا الإيمان نمشي يا عذر ياخدنا بعيد ونعيش بمحبة وأمان ليش هيدا خي هيدا مش خي يا زمان ليش ليش يا زمان ليش ليش يا زمان
On the eve of the concluding ceremonies, yet another large concert was organized. The idea of cooperation between religions is being promoted with ever greater intensity. Christian truth is being relativized. A new global spirituality is now emerging with the participation of all religions and with the cooperation, unfortunately, of the Orthodox ecumenists. The Pope's address was proof that a new world order is dawning. Our meeting today in St. Peter's Square, the Pope said, among other things, represents a new step in the journey which we began 13 years ago in Assisi. Praying in many languages, we ask the Spirit of God to enlighten, guide and strengthen us, that as men and women inspired by their faith, we may succeed in working together to build the future of humanity in harmony, justice, peace and love. A silent, pan-religious act of common prayer lent a manifestly liturgical character to the concluding ceremony and sent a strongly syncretistic message. The many lights of the different religions, when joined together, dispel the darkness of the world. The singing of the young people belonging to the Papist Focolari movement, whose directress speaks even in Muslim mosques about the promotion of interfaith dialogues, aroused unanimous enthusiasm. Now, would the holy apostles and the God-bearing fathers of Orthodoxy have contemplated working together with the heresies and religions of their day for the peace and salvation of the world? Would they have taken part in interfaith meetings in which the light of our holy faith was placed on the same level as the lights of error? When will the Orthodox ecumenists wake up and repent for the great sin of participating in this galloping syncretism? And how long will they follow the heresiarch Pope without a murmur of protest in his catastrophic journey away from the truth?